Welcome to the call. I'm so glad that you could join me today. It is an exciting time of year, isn't it? You know, it's the beginning of January, the beginning of 2013, a whole new year ahead. And many of us have made those New Year's resolutions, and we are looking forward with much anticipation and hope to having a fabulous year. And what I want to do is give you not just a way of hoping, but a way of actually being able to give yourself the tools to be able to get that success, to be able to go beyond just dreaming about it, but to bring it into reality. Because, you know, statistics say that by, 88% of everyone who makes New Year's resolutions, by January 31st, they're done. And that 52% of that 88% at the beginning thought that they were going to be able to do it differently this time. And I want to make sure that you can do it differently this time. So today what I'm going to do is give you an overview of four steps. And then at the end, I'm going to tell you about a group that's beginning January 22nd that's going to go through each of the steps that I'm talking about today very carefully, so that you can integrate them. For those of you who want to really knock it out of the park, you're going to be able to integrate these steps in a four-week group program. And so what I want to do is tell you exactly what we're going to cover today, and then I'm going to tell you a little bit about me. So what we're going to cover is, the first thing is designing a compelling vision, something that's going to get you to wake up in the morning and jump out of bed, because you've got a compelling vision that's bringing you forward, really like as if it's pulling you towards it. Instead of being pushed from behind, you're going to be pulled from the front and really being pulled towards what your vision is. The next thing we're going to do is actually talk about how to blast past procrastination and break through stumbling blocks each time it comes up. Wouldn't that be nice, right? That would be great to be able to break through that resistance. So I want to give you an out-of-the-box tool that's going to help you do that. And then we're going to look at how come you know and be convinced that you actually have what it takes to actually have your goals come true. And so we're going to discover how to do that. And then lastly, we're going to look at the practical. We're going to look at a daily method of operation, because it's not what you do every day, it's what you do daily. So when I say that, you know, that's something great that you could write down. And I hope that you've got pen and paper or computer or phone or pad that you can use to take some notes today. Because I want you to be able to really start as soon as we finish today to really be able to make some difference in your life. And I'll tell you why I'm so passionate about it. Is because after being very successful as a yacht broker, after being chairman of boards of daycare centers or nonprofits, being an entrepreneur early on in my life, being a school-based social worker, a teacher, after all of that and all of that success, I had this period of time where I went through what I call the dark night of the soul, or 40 days and 40 nights in the desert. And I wish it had only been 40 days and 40 nights. But 40 means as long as it takes. And it took me longer. And in that Disney World ride to the bottom of my finances, I discovered a whole bunch of things about myself. And one of the things that I saw, that the pattern that I was doing, is I was running from myself. I don't know if any of the rest of you have done that, where you're running from who you are. And sometimes people move from place to place in the country, and then lo and behold, they show up and there they are. I did a little of that. But I also, what I did is I chased that shiny thing. I kept thinking, if I could just do this, I'd be wealthy. If I could just do that, I'd have what I wanted. And I was really looking at the people that were giving me the what to do without giving me the why to do it, which is why I'm known as a couple of things. One is the success coach, making the unknown known. And I'm going to do that for you tonight by giving you these unknown tools, these kind of secrets that I have discovered that I want to share with you and with as many people as possible. And the other thing is that I became known as the person with that no BS style, because it felt to me that getting the what to do really wasn't the answer. It was the how to do it. So through all of my struggle and strife, which is why I say sometimes success feels like it sucks, doesn't it? Because we're bright, we're capable, we're talented, we're gifted. I mean, you know, we know what to do, but how come we can't do it? That's what I find, and that's what I find is the greatest tragedy, actually, about procrastinating and those stumbling blocks, is that we stop feeling good about ourselves. We start to wonder and doubt about who we are and whether we really can make it. And that is, to me, even more damaging, more, I don't know, sad in a way, because it isn't just the money slipping through your fingers. It's that you doubt who you are. And I want to really give you tools that you can use when those moments come up, because they always do. We always find something, you know, that feels, you know, so overwhelming that we can't figure out how to move forward. And so I want you to have the tools handy so that you can know how in the moment to break through that. And then to have your daily method of operation to be able to follow through. Because it really is these secrets that I'm going to share with you that made the difference in my life and being able to turn myself around, and also in the lives and the finances and the feeling of confidence and security that my clients have. We're able to, you know, some of them were able to double their income. Others actually quadrupled their income, be able to have more clients, to be able to increase their business by 20%. So it just depends. And I want you to be able to do that as well. So I'm going to share these secrets with you. Actually, what I'd really love to do is shout them from the rooftops and really be able to have you experience that kind of success. And the thing that I always say and write this down, is that there is nothing to fix, just more of you to discover. There is nothing to fix, just more of you to discover. And when you start to see life from that point of view, that there's nothing to fix, because I don't know about you, but I thought I was broken. I thought if I could just fix this and just fix that, you know, if I could just do it, that I would be wealthy and happy, you know. Wealthy and happy would be two fabulous things, but it wasn't about fixing me. It was really learning that I came into this world complete, just exactly the way I am, and that I have all the tools, and you have all the tools you need to be able to be an outlandish, outrageous, delightful success personally and professionally. And I'll go into that a little more in a minute. But what I want to do with you is to talk about first, the first step being that compelling vision. So write this down. If I knew without a question of the doubt that I could be successful, that there were no limits of time or money, and that success was guaranteed, what would I be doing? What would you be doing? Success is guaranteed. Take that in for a moment and really experience that. Wow, if success was guaranteed with whatever I had a compelling vision to do, what would I be doing? And think about that. And then when you think about that and you've written something down, consider what the outcome of the outcome would be. Write that down. The outcome of the outcome would be. Because it's not about having the $10,000 in every month. It's not about the $50,000 every month. It's not about the money, is it? It's really about the feeling that we have, the experience that we want to give ourselves. I mean, do you want to experience climbing to the top of Mount Kilimanjaro and placing your own flag up at the top? That experience, that exhilaration of satisfaction of accomplishing that physically, emotionally, mentally, that feeling. Is that it? What is the feeling you want? Is the feeling you want that you have created a legacy for your children and there's a charity that you have that you give, and the satisfaction of seeing the children or the elderly, or the people, someone in Africa or in India or wherever the country is that is of your heart, Haiti, that, you know, your legacy is there and your foundation is supporting children, and that feeling of pride, that you created that. What is that feeling? And put that in your compelling vision. The outcome of the outcome. So if you earn $10,000 a month, or 20 or 30, what is the outcome of that? Well, the outcome of that is I could set up my nonprofit. And what is the outcome of that? Well, the outcome of setting up my nonprofit is that I could know that my vision to be supporting children in Africa and educating children in Africa can be fulfilled. And what is the outcome of that outcome? Well, that I could go to Africa and stand around and see all of those young ladies ready to go off to high school, to college, to know that they had a future for their children. And that by earning that amount of money, that my children have a future as well. And so there's the outcome of the outcome. So create your compelling vision. And now, in order to be able to really be able to follow through on that compelling vision, what you need to do is to know how you actually feel. And you're thinking, oh, Marty, I mean, really, are you going to talk to me about how I feel? I thought we were talking about business. I thought we were going to, you know, really knock it out of the park. Well, in fact, your feelings are one of the greatest sources of information that you have. Now, we've been raised to believe that some feelings are good and some feelings are bad, and that we don't want to feel the feelings of anger, regret, resentment, remorse, depression, incompetent, incapable, not good enough, never going to make it. And yet, what if you consider that in those feelings are the richest, most juiciest information that you needed in that moment to be able to move forward? What if? You see, what I discovered in my Disney World ride to the bottom of my finances, where at one point there was a Christmas where I really had to consider not how many presents I was going to get my children, but if I was going to get them presents. And that was not a good evening. And when I was able to turn that around, when I was able to look inside, I was able to see that what I was doing with the five companies that I was running, working 10, 12, 14 hours a day, going financially nowhere, that I was out of integrity with myself, that I was running from myself, running from myself. I didn't want to know that I felt incapable, not good enough, never going to make it. I didn't want to stop long enough to possibly know that maybe I didn't have enough tools or I didn't have enough skills to be able to do it. I didn't want to know. And so I kept working harder. Some of you may have experienced that yourself. And when I realized that I was out of integrity with myself, and I stopped, and in one day I closed all my companies, and I began to write my book, my private sessions, Intimate Secrets to Unlock Your Potential, which you can get up on Amazon if you like, which will give you a lot of details about what I'm going to go over tonight. So you may want to get it. And so when I did that and I stopped and I was of integrity with myself because I was doing what I loved, I wrote for 12 hours the first day. 12 hours when I got in touch with how I felt. I didn't even stop for food. I don't remember anything. I just remember, you know, starting to write and it was light outside and finishing writing and it was midnight. And so that's what happens when we tap into our feelings and know exactly how we feel. Then we have the resources. And people always love it when I teach them about the science of emotions. You see, what we were raised with was really the myth about emotions. Some are good, some are bad. Don't want these, want to keep these, think positive, and all of that. And it's really more than that. It's really being exactly where you are in the moment in order to get where you're going. So write that down. Start where you are to get where you're going. You got to start where you are. So I'm going to show you how feelings actually scientifically work, the quantum physics of emotions. I'm going to do my fabulous drawing for you here. Have a little fun here. Okay. So, actually, it's pretty fascinating stuff, and it's so simple that you're going to, like, wonder why you never knew this before. And some intuitively you may have already figured it out, at least pieces of it, if not all of it. But if you talk about having a gut feeling, a gut reaction, that you have a gut ache, that some people say that your gut is your second brain, right? Well, in fact, it's your seat of creativity. So if you put your hand on your belly, that is your creativity center. And so this is the, let's use this color here, creativity center. And this is where and I forgot to warn you. You know, I'm going to have to ask you to be willing to be willing. I'm going to have to ask you to be willing to be willing to allow yourself to know new information, to allow yourself to be willing to consider some new ideas. Because at times you may feel like I've got you walking on your hands because what I'm going to say to you is so out of the box and cutting edge. So if you're willing, that would be fabulous for you to be able to have this opportunity to check it out and just see how it could actually make a big difference for you. And so you have your creativity center, and that's where your feelings are. And if you breathe in and you allow yourself to feel, you'll get a sense of that. What often happens, however, is that when those feelings come up that we don't want to know about, what happens, another part of our body comes in to help us out, right? And so that part of your body is right here. It's your solar plexus. And your solar plexus, you probably are pretty familiar with it because you get a tummy ache and it shuts down. And you say, oh, I just wish that pain would go away. And that is your solar plexus. And that's exactly what it does, is it shuts down so that you don't feel. It's trying to be your best friend, because all of our body is just our best friend. It tells us exactly what we need to know in the moment. So it's saying, well, you're shut down, you don't want to feel, okay, I'm going to help you out. And what happens is that it's a very interesting path that your feeling then has to travel, because it can't go into your heart. So what it does is it actually goes into a part of your brain, which is back here. It's the bump on the back of your head, and it's known as the limbic brain. Your reptilian brain is also back there, and your reptilian brain is the thing that keeps all of our functioning, eating, digesting, everything else about our body. Just keeps like a, you know, obviously like a time clock. It just runs. We don't have to worry about it. We don't have to think about it. So that ancient brain of the reptilian brain takes care of all that for us. And this part of the ancient brain, the limbic brain, what that does is that is your fight or flight, fight or flight, fight or flight. So that's the part of my brain that was activating. And the fascinating thing about the limbic brain is it recycles. It's a self-referring brain that just recycles what it's got in there. So that, it's really like a broken record. What happens is that when we're in that fight or flight response, we can't think. Because you see, right here is your frontal lobe. And your frontal lobe is where you decode. So your frontal lobe is where you decode information. And when you're in your fight or flight brain, you can't decode, right? And it's like if you picture like in second or third grade, you know, you were studying the dinosaurs and the cavemen and that kind of thing. And they had no frontal lobe, right? The Neanderthal kind of looked like that with no brain. And that's because it literally in our evolution hadn't developed. It hadn't grown. And so without that frontal lobe to process, what happened is that they would, you know, see the dinosaur, right, and run. See the dinosaur and run. See the dinosaur and run. You know, big creature for them, that big thing. But they couldn't process that the poop on the ground meant that there was dinosaurs living here and they really ought to be living somewhere else. They needed to move out of the area. They couldn't put the two things together. And that's what happens for us is we can't process the information. And because this is really important, it's kind of a little diversion, but I just want to tell you that children under at four and under and really up to about 6-7 years old also cannot process the word no. So I'm throwing that in there because I just have talked to so many parents that were so grateful. I just wanted to let you know. Because the child's frontal lobe also has not developed. They don't start, it doesn't grow and develop into a processing brain until closer to like the end of like in 6-7 years old. And so when you tell them no, what they hear is yes. So now you'll understand that when you tell them not to do something and they do it and they're so proud and they smile and you're wondering how come they're smiling when they did something you told them not to, it's because they heard yes. So I just quickly threw that in because it's the same thing about the brain. So with the limbic brain, what it tells us over and over and over and over and over again is that we're not good enough. So not good enough. Over and over. And you've experienced that. You know, when things, you just keep recycling it. You know, you think about the future and you think, ah, I got it. And then that brain comes up and gives you the conversation about how you're not going to make it. And, you know, I always told you weren't going to be able to do it. And so that recycling brain projects into the future what was happened in the past. And so the cool thing is, though, that we can make a difference with that. And how we can make a difference with that is to be able to allow ourselves to feel. To allow ourselves to feel by opening our solar plexus, letting a feeling go into our heart, into our frontal lobe, and then into the reptilian brain. Excuse me, into the limbic brain. And when we do that, and we decode it. So let's do that. So let's say, which often can show up for people, not good enough. So we're feeling not good enough, and we allow ourselves to feel it, and it's like, wow, not good enough. I don't see how I'm going to make it. I mean, I don't feel good enough today. And when I can learn to do that, when you can learn to say, not good enough, what did you show up to teach me today? What are you here to teach me? And not good enough, my best friend says, well, Marty, you know that marketing? You remember that Facebook, those Facebook videos? Those are waiting for you. And if you go and you watch those Facebook videos, you're going to feel really good about yourself. You're going to know exactly how to do it when you get on Facebook. And so you don't have to feel uncomfortable like you do every day. Because you're going to know exactly what to do. And you're going to feel not only not good enough, but you're going to feel good enough. Wow, not good enough. Thanks for showing up. I forgot about the videos. You're right. That is why I was feeling insecure and not good enough today. I always go and I don't know what to do. So, yay, I can do that. All right. And so what happens is that not good enough becomes good enough. And then that goes to the limbic brain, and the limbic brain learns something new, which is good enough, good enough, good enough. And you just breathe it in. Take 3 deep breaths and breathe it in so that your limbic brain will get new information. You entrain your body. And we'll go over each of these pieces in the group. I'm going to spend a whole hour so you can really understand it in great detail. But I wanted to give you the essence of these steps so that you could begin to take a look at it yourself and really start to think about how you can add something new to your toolbox so that you can feel, know for sure that you're going to be able to make a difference. Because, you know, you want to think like, well, if I don't add anything to my toolbox, if I don't change the way I'm doing things, I mean, what will mean that I'm going to have 2013 be any different? Because if you keep repeating what you did in 2012 in 2013, well, obviously, logically, there can't be any change because you're just repeating, like, not good enough, not good enough. You're going to repeat it over and over again and just bring out the same result. So what we want to do is help you to be able to change that. And so that's what the group will do, is give you a whole hour on figuring that out so you can be sure that when, you know, when procrastination rears its head, that you will go, ah, let me check and see how I feel. Because that's what keeps us with stumbling blocks and procrastination, is that not knowing how we feel. And that's when we run, like I did, and we run from ourselves. And so we put it off and we resist. And I want you to write this down for sure. What you resist persists. What you resist persists. The very thing you don't want to have happen in your life shows up, doesn't it, over and over. And again, we'll talk more about that in the group. But now what I want to talk to you about is another really crucial thing about who you are and why, in fact, you absolutely have what it takes to be able to be successful and to know that you have what it takes to be successful rather than just hoping and wishing and, you know, wishing on a star. But you're actually going to know. And that's your talents, your abilities, and gifts. You see, because we came into this world complete, exactly as we are. We came in with our talents, our abilities, and our gifts, and our feelings. And this is your talents, abilities, and gifts is the essence of who you are. It's really the essence of who you are. And most people, when I ask them, I say, you know, tell me an ability. Tell me a talent. They go, I don't know, do I have any? And then usually what we can do is fill the whole whiteboard. This is one of the exercises that my one-on-one clients absolutely end up falling in love with. And because they discover more about who they are. And once you really know who you are, then you can fall in love with yourself. Don't you love it when people would say to you, you know, just love yourself? And you're thinking, well, I get that, but how do I love myself? Well, this is actually how you can start to love yourself. Let me move that over a little bit. So your talents, your abilities, and your gifts. Let's take our friend Mozart, all right? Because he came in and he could just play the piano. And that's an ability. It's just what you can do naturally is your ability. It just shows up. It's the thing that people say to you, how do you do that? And you say, do what? I mean, I can just do it, right? That's an ability. And you know what's really cool? That's what you get to charge the most for. Your ability is what you get to charge the most for, not the least for. And we have spent years not charging for something that just came naturally because we didn't think we had the right to or whatever it was, right? I mean, I've been able to help people with their business, help people. I mean, by sixth grade, I was called mom. In kindergarten, I was organizing the playground. I just have always been able to help people and guide people. I've been able to help businesses, you know, but I wasn't charging for it, you know, and I thought, wow, I could make an income with this, you know, and be able to really help people. So think about that. So with Mozart, his ability was to be creative. And his gift was to play the piano. 4 years old, playing the piano. His talent was playing the piano. His gift was being able to also, with his creativity, he could also write music. And his gift was concertos, operas, sonatas, right? that have influenced musicians for generations, right? So that's his gift. So another ability might be someone who loves to paint, right? So their creativity is their ability. Their talent is being a painter. And their gift is the exhibit at the museum, where they share it. So you want to look at what comes naturally. Maybe perhaps you are analytical. Let's say analytical, because I got a lot of entrepreneurs and coaches on the phone. So analytical. So if you're analytical, you might do any number of 1,000 things. But one of the things you might do is you might be an organizer, right? But your ability to organize, what makes you able to organize for many people is that they're analytical, can figure out where things go, how the big pieces go together. So we'll say that your talent is as an organizer. And your gift is you actually organize closets, you come into homes, you set everything up so that people feel more comfortable, more relaxed. So you're an organizer, so you organize homes and makes homes feel more comfortable for the owners. Now, you may be saying, okay, Marty, all right, I sort of get this, right? And again, we'll spend an hour on this in the group. But I sort of get this. But I thought we were talking about business. What are you talking about talents, gifts, and abilities for? I mean, what's that about? Well, what it's about is that what we'll also talk about in the group is how your talents are a business skill and give you business success. Because it doesn't matter if one of your abilities is that you're a cook, or your talent is that you're a cook, and that would also be an expression of creativity. And as a cook, what does it take to cook, right? You've got to measure. You've got to know when to add, know when to stir, know when to put it in the oven, know when to take it out. You've got to know what spices to add, know what spices to leave out, right? You have to know timing, measurement, finesse to be a fabulous cook. So your gift as a cook is not just to have a delightful meal that everybody wants to come over and have, but as a business person and you're negotiating, what do you use? You have to know when to add spice to a negotiation. You have to know when to hold back. You have to know when to stir the pot. You got to know when to, how to measure, when to say what. You have to know timing, right? That's what it's all about. So you'll see how your talents then expand the possibilities of you, give you more tools in your toolbox. So you're not just, you know, it's sort of like we run around with, you know, like 3 things that we can pull from. And we keep using those things over and over and over and over again. But as you see that inside of you, you have an infinite resource of who you are. And that's where you're going to be like the butterfly coming out of the cocoon, where you're going to learn how to use this ability in a new way because you've bumped up to a situation. So it's not that we're not good enough. It's that we're discovering more of who we are. So when the project fails and you take a look at what pleased you and what displeased you about how you manage that situation, you learn something new about yourself, right? Where you can use this gift that you have. I mean, people, clients have been able to go from stuck and stumbling and struggling and strifing when we've looked at feelings, looked at talents, gifts, and abilities, and put them together so that they knew how they felt, and then they knew which talent, gift, or ability to use to making, you know, doubling their income, having more connected relationships. You know, that's what people want. They want more connected relations. They want authenticity. When you know more about yourself, you can feel more confident, more self-assured, and to feel great about yourself, and to be able to break through that stumbling block and blast past that procrastination, because you actually have something to work with. Oh, that's why I'm so cool. I knew I was cool, but I didn't know why I was cool. And in fact, what I've had is clients who, I had one gentleman who was actually very successful. He was a multimillionaire, had 3 businesses, and so we were designing this huge, elaborate, multimillion-dollar plan for him. And he wanted the house, the boat, you know, the house on the water, the boat in the lake, and all of that. And after just working with me for about a month, he said, you know what, Marty? I like myself now. And you know what? Why I wanted all that stuff was to have more connected relationship with my family, to have create memories with my children. And that's that compelling vision, combined with feeling great about yourself because you know why you're so cool. So that's what that is all about. So, and so now what we're going to do is we're going to add the practical step, which is creating your DMO. And your DMO is your daily method of operation. And we're just going to briefly touch on this. And what it is that it's not what you do every day. It's what you do daily that makes the difference. And when you have your, you're going to, in the group, we'll customize the DMO so that it fits your style and who you are. But some basic principles are good for all of us, which is when you look at your daily method of operation, what you want to do is look at, you want to back schedule. So where do you want to be a year from now? And what will it take to be there 6 months from now? And 6 months from now, what will it take to be there? So you have to look at 3 months to get to 6 months. And then at 3 months, you got to look at 1 month. And 1 month, you're going to look at 1 week. And with 1 week, you're going to look at 1 day. So what can you do today in order to be able to have the 12-month compelling vision goal experienced? So you're going to back schedule. So if you want to be earning $100,000 by January of next year, what do you have to have done by June of this year? How many clients do you need? How many and how do you get those clients? How many conversations do you need to have in order to have that number of clients at that level of income? And again, we'll go over that carefully in the group. So that's one basic idea, is to back schedule. The other is to think about, often, of course, it's a, what we usually call time management. It's really prioritizing. And so one way to help you prioritize is to really, at night, is to make a list. That's when it's great, and you know what you do and need to do in the morning. So you're going to write out your list at night, and your brain will have time to kind of work on it while you sleep. And then in the morning, when you wake up, you're all set to go. The trick is allowing yourself to do what's on the list and not create another list. Well, that'll take some awareness on your part. So when you wake up in the morning, what could be on your DMO list is to experience that compelling vision. Feel the feeling that you want to have with that compelling vision realized. Just lie in bed and just feel what that feels like. Who will you be with? What will you be doing? What will that feeling be? And then what many people like to do is to do gratitudes. To think about the things that you have that you can be grateful for. To kind of get you, kickstart you into that feeling of a nice flow of energy in your body. Of thinking of the glass full, half full to full. So that you can experience the abundance of situations rather than the deprivation of situations. So you start to get a mindset about of abundance of a situation and what's there for you to learn. And then you might get up and go down and get a big pad, you know, where you could write your intention. And to get some colored markers, you know, and have fun with it, you know, at the dollar store, you can get, you know, like 60 of these for a dollar. And what I do is then write my intention. I might even post it someplace for the day. Who am I being? Am I going to be bold? Am I going to be unstoppable? Who am I being today? Am I going to be a problem solver? Am I going to be imaginative, creative, inventive, so I can write a fabulous blog for my profit club members? And, you know, what is it for you? What is it that, who are you going to be? And what is your intention for the day? And then what I recommend is that you read, 10, 15 minutes of a book that has a message that uplifts you, whatever book that is. And then it's starting the rest of your day. You may also want to exercise. Many people like to do that in the morning. Others do it later in the day. But you may want to exercise from 10 minutes to an hour, whatever works for you, to get that energy going and moving. And then begin the rest of your day with all of that nice foundation built. And so with the group, what we'll do is we'll really design that specifically for you do that. And so let's do a few review. I mean, we've been through a lot here already. So what we looked at is creating that compelling vision that I just mentioned again. So your compelling vision, what is the outcome of the outcome, the experience that you want? You learned about how to blast past procrastinations and stumbling blocks, because what you're going to do is you're going to know how you feel. You're going to allow yourself to breathe and allow that feeling to come up. And then know that the world is dualistic. So when you feel not good enough, it's letting you know where you are good enough. And so you're then able to use the what's not good enough to tell you exactly what you need to do in the moment. So that'll help you be able to pick up the phone and not let that money slip through your fingers, because you're not doing your follow-up. You'll be able to go, oh, that's why I'm afraid. I know. I can go out on the internet and I can figure out that what that executive does, and I can check their Facebook and go to their LinkedIn and learn more about them before I give them a call. And so then you can feel more comfortable, and then you can act. And then you're going to know your talents, your abilities, and your gifts. You can know where you can pull from within you, what other resources you have available to be able to, as I say, like the butterfly, kind of spread your wings and know different aspects of yourself that you can discover and use to feel comfortable and secure in who you are. And then you've got your daily method of operation that you've designed, from back scheduling from a year to the day to the hour, giving yourself a list at night, and waking up in the morning with your routine that you design so that you can feel good and ready for your day. And so that's what can be possible if you allow yourself to really take a hold of these ideas, these concepts, and really be able to move forward with them. But I'd like you to consider what it would be like if you don't do that, if you don't make any changes. I mean, where will you, when I'm talking to people, where will you be? How many clients will you have at the end of the month if you do things exactly as you're doing right now? And if it's great, then go for it, keep doing it. But if it's not, if you don't change anything, what's really going to make the difference? How much money are you actually losing by not being able to pick up the phone? What if you could, share your absolutely fabulous product, your ideas, your concepts, your coaching with someone who needs it and wants it, and you do it in a way where they actually do it? How if you had a couple of more of those people that actually were embracing and getting what they needed from you? How much more money would you have in the bank? How would you feel about yourself if you make that change? And then how will you feel about yourself knowing that you can, but you didn't? And so that you're like, dang, missed that opportunity, And think about, aspects of like your health, your wealth, your relationships that are being affected by not being able to move forward when those stumbling blocks come up. And you're stuck and struggling. And as I say, the tragedy, the thing about procrastination is how we don't feel good about ourselves. And then that affects all parts of every aspect of our life, including our health. So we might end up eating more to try to shove it down so that we don't feel. And yet we're running, running for myself. I don't want you to do what I did. Don't take that Disney World ride with me down to the bottom where I was. I want you to take the ride back up with the little engine that could. I think I can. When you have these tools in your toolbox, you'll know that you can. It won't even be, I think I can, because you're going to feel resistance and go, there it is. There's resistance. Yippee. Must be great. I must have something really exciting right now that I can do. And step into it and step into that resistance and be able to break through it. Wouldn't that be cool to be able to do that for yourself?